Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Hearthstone Singapore Major. Once again, I am TJ, and I have kicked Lothar out of the Hearthstone casting room, and I brought in Pathra. Pathra, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. It's been a fun day of matches so far.
Uh-huh.
We saw the two winners bracket matches, but now it's time to move on to the losers bracket, the low bracket, the win or go home matches, the do or die matches.
It's Crazy Mage versus Next Gen, and they're both from Vietnam.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, and Next Gen is actually the player that was voted in, a player from mm-hmm. each of the countries.
People's choice.
The people's choice. Yeah, they had a chance to vote, and Next Gen got his travel paid for because he was voted in. So definitely a cool thing to see, and you can see the players getting ready there.
So they must know each other.
Yeah, it's probably both being from Vietnam. The Southeast Asian Hearthstone community seems really close-knit among a lot of the communities. Like the Singaporean community has a lot of players from like Team Mana Surge. Mm-hmm. The Malaysian community has a lot of players from M8. So there's a lot of camaraderie among each of the individual countries. So I can imagine that they do have that.
So this is a oil rogue versus a... Is this a...
Aggro? It's aggro druid. Don't be confused by the warlock icon.
I saw the warlock icon and I got a bit confused there.
Yeah. So the Fel Reaver. Aggro Druid is such an interesting deck. Just because, you know, it's a mid-range druid is already so strong.
Yes,
so
yes.
Like, why change it? Why put in risky cards like a Fel Reaver and, you know, take out some of the consistency of mid-range druid?
Well, the aggro druid seems to do quite okay against some of the other aggro decks.
Yeah.
Like Zoo.
Yeah, because a lot of times you can just race him.
Mm-hmm.
You pop down a Fel Reaver, a lot of times Zoo Warlocks or just don't have a way to deal with a big threat like that.
They don't run Big Game Hunter in aggro decks.
Yeah.
Wow, Darnassus right off the start there.
Yeah. It's a good start. Even if it's dealt with, it still demands an answer, which is a big thing. If not, then it leads into turn four, which could be Pilot of Treader, double Druid of the Saber, potentially. And... Okay. Well. Deadly Poison is going to deal with it pretty nicely.
So we're just gonna, see the stealth mode here.
Yeah.
So.
Gonna throw out the 1/1s as well. And the win condition for basically the aggro druid is sort of similar to mid-range druid in the fact that you just want to build up a board and then finish the game with combo. But they have creatures that are a lot harder to remove and more creatures that do immediate damage or immediate things. So. The Druid of the Saber has the charge or stealth, which both instances sort of almost always guarantee you damage. Fel Reaver is really hard to remove, especially if it's innervated out. And then they can close out the game a lot quicker. Do you think it does well against Rogue?
I'm not a big Rogue player, but I think the aggro Druid, I think it might be a 50-50 match.
Yeah, it's pretty close. I'd say so. Rogues tends to struggle with... faster decks, just because it doesn't allow them to tempo effectively, but they do have saps, which is good for dealing with things that are innervated out, like a Fel Reaver.
Yeah, and Crazy Mage has two sprints in his hand, well, with a prep, so he might do that next turn.
It's still awkward, even with both sprints.
Yeah.
If that other sprint was like an Eviscerate or a second prep, be in a lot better shape, but... still not too bad of a play. He'll be able to reload his hand.
Mm-hmm.
And Next Gen hasn't really picked up those big early bombs yet. He does have Dr. Boom. But other than that, there's not much that's going to apply too much pressure. And this turn's a little bit awkward. You can trade in, or you can use a swipe to clear off a 3-3. Oh, yeah!
He's going to trade. Oh, wow, he's going straight face there.
Trade? This is an aggro druid. We never trade.
Smork all the way.
That is correct. Because a lot of times you can't really worry about what your opponent's going to do with their creatures. As an aggro druid, sometimes you know, all memes aside, you just have to look at your cards and you have to look at their health total. And how quickly you can make your cards put that health total to zero. And that is the life of an aggro druid.
Yeah, it is pretty scary if they had a flurry, though, and just wiped your whole board.
Yeah, that's true.
But I guess they don't care about that. It's just like all face.
Yeah. The one scary thing, though, for next gen is that he can't reload. Like, he can't reload the board if he did get blown out.
Yeah.
I don't think he's really worried too much about that.
He doesn't seem to have a turn five, so maybe he can draw into one.
Yeah. Crazy Mage picks up turn five with this Sludge Belcher. And also picks up a... I think that was a backstab. Yeah, that was a backstab that he pointed at it, so... he is going to be able to... Ooh! Huh. I'm actually really surprised that he gave up that. But I guess without a Blade Flurry in his hand, he realizes that that Deadly Poison's probably not going to do too much, but that Deadly Poison was effectively just a regular dagger.
This is kind of awkward for next gen here. Does he hero power or actually swipe the face?
I'll give you one guess.
Swipe the face.
Swipe the face.
More damage.
More damage.
Ooh. All right,
which emote? Okay, he picked the correct emote as well. All right. Yeah, this is just sort of how it plays. You're not going to really find too many good swipe targets against the rogue anyway. A lot of times it's Violet Teacher, and he does have the second swipe, so you're okay with giving up that first one. Ooh.
You really have to force of nature here.
It's
not.
Which card do you value more, though? Do you value force of nature or swipe? Because both deal with the Sludge Belcher just about equally. You just have to take a little bit of extra damage if you use the swipe.
I think maybe the force of nature here, and then next turn, Dr. Boom.
Sorry about that.
Oh, man. he almost pointed the swipe at the face. Yeah, it's a little bit of a tough turn. I think you might value the Force of Nature just a little bit more, just because, you know, it can combo later with something else, and swipe really can't. You know, swipe's never going to be much anything more than just...
But it's so good against the Violet Teacher.
It is, yeah. That's true. That's very true. Still going to play Dr. Boom next turn, pretty much regardless.
Mm-hmm. So now the rogue. Probably just the Azure Drake here.
Yeah.
Or the Violet Teacher.
Violet Teacher. The only thing is that Violet Teacher allows him to dagger. Options. But.
Pay attention, class.
Tinker Sharp Sword Oil. No Blade Flurry. Tinker Sharp Sword Oil sort of is a not a liability, but it's tough to get full value out of it with the Violet Teacher on the board because. The oil can fall onto the 1/1s. But it doesn't matter because Dr. Boom is played. Sap is good, but it's not that good. The thing is, Crazy Mage just has a lot of cards. So he can fully clear here with a Phantom Knives and a Sap. And if that's going to be your case, unless you think you're going to pick up a better play, it's better to Phantom Knives or Sap first, just so the Boom Bots are less likely to hit your Violet Teacher when you... Fan of knives, because there'll be one extra 1/1 in play.
That's like a really good turn for a Crazy Mage.
Oh, actually just gonna... I'm ready to learn. Eviscerate face! Trading the smork and building up a big Edwin Finn Cleave. It's moderately sized. But I like this play, you know?
Yeah, that's a really good play.
Yeah.
I knew that Edwin was coming down.
It's actually a lot better than the Phantom Knives just because it allows... He still clears the Boombots off the board, but he ends up building quite a large...
So what do you think about the Knife Juggler and the Force of Nature here?
It's a potential board clear with...
Some knives.
No, it's not. It's not a board clear because you get three knives in there, so you'd have... 9 total damage to split across 4, 5, 10 total health. So, if it was perfect, it would hit the slime.
Sorry about
And they would hit the Violet Teacher once and the Edwin once. Oh, wow.
A lot of BM there.
So I could say that these players do know each other quite well. To not be fazed by the friendly BM. It's got to go quick. There are animations, especially with the juggles. That's a good juggle.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good juggle. If it hits the Violet Teacher, that's a perfect outcome. Okay.
Oh, he didn't get the last one in.
No, not quite.
It's because of the juggles. They just took too long.
Yeah. Whoa.
Ouch.
Yeah, Crazy Mage just rubbing it in. But, you know, Next Gen still is in an okay spot. He's at 20 health.
Yeah, that's still a good amount of HP.
And now Crazy Mage always has to keep in the back of his mind, well, I die to combo.
That's true. But he doesn't know that Next Gen doesn't have any of his combo pieces in his hand.
Yeah. He did make some. He knows one of the cards in his hand is a Dr. Boom. Yeah. Ooh, Blade Flurry. Phantom Knives, though, does take care of the Knife Juggler. And next turn, he puts together so much damage. He's got Tinker Sharp's Oil plus Blade Flurry. And he's going to push even more damage this turn. So we could be looking at a lethal situation for Crazy Mage. And Haunted Creeper off the top is one of the worst possible draws.
Yeah.
So let's count.
Clear this.
Yeah. 9, 10. Sharp's Oil, Blade Flurry is easily lethal. Regardless of where the... whether you combo the oil or not.
Yeah, so Crazy Mage is going to have lethal next turn?
Yeah. The Next Gen looks very sad.
Hmm. Well, it's been a crazy game. It was like back and forth.
Yeah.
I thought Next Gen was going to take it, but then now Crazy Mage made a comeback.
Oh. A Redagger plus a Tinker's plus a Blade Flurry is a guaranteed lethal. But double Tinkers is also... No, double Tinkers is... Yeah, double Tinkers is also. Because it'd be an extra 6 damage, with 10 damage total being represented at the moment. So, either way. This is also lethal. Many ways to find lethal this turn.
He's thinking of the best possible way.
Yeah. How can I use the most possible cards? Wait.
He's gonna Blade Flurry. What?
No, he did. This isn't lethal.
This is. It is.
Oh, yeah, he has a spell power. He has a spell power.
Yeah.
Yeah. He scared me. For some reason, it looked like a 6.
No.
And I was like, he doesn't have enough mana to dagger up, but he got it.
He knows what he's doing.
He found it. All right, well, that's Crazy Mage taking game number 1 with the Rogue.
And it was a really good game.
Yeah. A little bit of an awkward hand for an aggro druid to have, I think. Especially early on. Stuck with a lot of spells.
So that sprint came in handy, actually.
He
didn't end up using his other sprint. It was still in his hand, right?
Didn't. Yeah. A lot of times that's the case. You sort of run the 2 sprints just to have consistency of draw. Like you consistently being able to draw the sprint. Double sprint's really only good in like super control matchups. You only ever use the second one in control priest sometimes or control warrior. So
what do you think we're going to see next?
Well, the Rogue's out of the way, so that opens up Next Gen to play his Warlock deck if it's Zoo. So, if I had to guess, I'd say, yeah, Zoo Warlock versus...
Zoo versus...
Druid.
Mid-range Druid.
So what do you think of this matchup?
You know what? I know that Zoo is slightly favored, but Druid is such a good deck that I know that Druids can still beat Zoos.
Yeah. We actually saw it earlier as well, in the Handsome Guy versus Tansuki.
One really good board clear for a druid, it's usually like hard for a zoo to rebuild their board again.
Yeah. You have to have really sticky creatures on the board in the first place to make themselves resilient.
Well, he has the Wild Growth. Crazy Mage has the Wild Growth, so that's a pretty good start for him.
Yeah. Swipe is such a good card in this matchup, but if you already have a good curve with Wild Growth and the Keeper, a lot of times you don't need the swipe, but I might be inclined to keep that regardless.
Yeah, it's always nice to have the swipe in your hand.
But look at that curve. Keep her into Azure Drake.
That's really nice.
Yeah. Next gen's is decent as well. He's got to think here. This is always the sort of risk with Knife Juggler plus another 2-drop, the decision in playing them, because Knife Juggler gets contested.
Well, the Knife Juggler would be better here, but next gen doesn't know whether he has an innervate or not, because usually when you put a Knife Juggler, they innervate on turn 2 and kill it with their Keeper of Crow.
Yeah. Well,
he just got it.
That is exactly almost correct.
But he didn't have that before.
Yeah. And Crazy Mage gives a little bit of a cheeky smile there. Power overwhelming is usually the go-to, especially against Druid. Against board control, or like decks where board control is a little bit more important, like against other Zoo Warlocks. Sometimes you'll pick the Mortal Coil if you think that it's going to have a good target pretty early on in the game. But
I like the power overwhelming pick also.
Yeah. And next gen, it's a possibility that he does run Leroy Jenkins as a finisher. Especially seeing the Sea Giant, a lot of times Leroy Jenkins goes hand in hand with the Sea Giant. Just because of the, you know, Sea Giant allows you to get the board control, which is what you're giving up when you take out Doom Guards. And Leroy just is a stronger finisher in general.
Yeah, true. I wonder if he runs Enhanzo and Bran, like the last the last couple of matches.
So far, we've seen a lot of Enhanzo Meccano, Bran Bronzebeard shenanigans. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see more.
Yeah, the Azure Drake seems good here. Just get more cards. Maybe even that swipe.
Yeah. More cards, especially. Yeah, I was going to say more cards, especially with an Emperor Thorsand turn coming up. Getting extra value on the reductions, but
he wants to get straight into that Emperor Thorsand.
Yeah. Not getting too much value off of the Emperor Thorsand, though. Three cards reduced, and all three cards aren't really huge swing cards. Azure Drake can be a big deal because you can pick up a spell and be able to combo that for less mana, which is pretty effective.
So it looks like next gen is thinking about power overwhelming his Imp Gang and just dropping the Gormog.
Yeah, Crazy Mage is pretty emote happy. And, you know, it's still a decently sized board. It just, using the Gormog without the battle cry seems rough, and next gen's hand is super awkward.
Yeah, he can't even play the Sea Giant at all.
Yeah. But 2-drops picked up, which allows him to combo it with the Defender of Argus.
Would you trade here or just go face?
I would go face.
Yeah, same here. Let him be the one to trade.
Yeah. Even with reductions, you'd have to have Azure Drake swipe both reduced, but I'll tell a small story here while we have a little bit of time.
Sure.
There's two players that taught me that going face is always the correct choice. Firebat and that's Admiral. Firebat, when he won the 2014 Hearthstone World Championship, he did things that no player before him had really ever done. And that was trade less and go face more. Mm. And if you go back and watch the Hearthstone World Championship VODs and watch like the round of 16 and onwards, everybody traded all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Even like some of the players that were considered some of the best in the tournament, like Tiller Celestial, who was like the runner-up. If you looked at that exact situation, he would have traded off his Gormog. And Firebat was one of the players who sort of changed the way and was one of the people. He was one of the first, the original smorkers, the OG smork.
Yeah, there are some situations where it's just really tough to figure out, like, do I trade? Do I go phase? I found myself in that position many times.
Yeah, and when in doubt,
you just go for the safer way.
No, when in doubt, go face.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
I thought it was just play it
safe.
That's
not a rule. That's my rule. That's not a general rule. You could take my advice, but it's risky.
Okay, he can actually Knife Juggler and Sea Giant here.
Yeah. There's no way that the knife would be able to kill off Well, he wouldn't play a minion before the sea giant anyway, so.
Why are you making these sounds?
He's
over
thinking
there?
About tapping, and I don't think you're ever going to find a better time to play the sea giant. Well, you might find a better time, but at that point it might be too late because you'd be
He's hesitating, but yeah, it's best to trade now before dropping the juggler and the sea giant. Why is that a mistake?
Because now he can't play the sea giant because he killed the creature.
Oh my gosh! No, yeah. No.
Yeah.
He was too caught up thinking about the knives.
Yeah.
Which is exactly what I was thinking about.
To be honest, I have no idea what he.
Wow.
Oh, man.
I can hear the crowd outside shouting.
Icing on the cake. Yikes.
Ouch.
There, the Azure Drake is a little bit. I understand his reasoning behind trading there. You know, the concept behind it, not the timing of when he did it, not the sequencing.
The sea giant is kind of tricky sometimes. You have to, like.
Oh, yeah.
It is.
Basic math can sometimes be tricky. Yeah, no, I see where you're coming from. So a lot of times you're so caught up in
thinking of one idea, and then it just you're just like, oh wait, oh it's too late.
Especially with cards like Implosion and Haunted Creeper, like trading in Haunted Creepers, like some of the hardest turns are when you have to calculate whether or not you'll still be able to play Sea Giant after implosioning off a creature, because you have to factor in the odds of if I roll 4, my board will be full, so I won't be able to play it anyway. But if I roll 2, I won't have enough things on the board to play the Sea Giant. So a Sea Giant can make for some difficult situations. But right now, that mistake is going to punish Next Gen.
Yes.
Yeah, it's not going to punish him that much, because the Sea Giant would have been killed by the Big Game Hunter anyway. But that would have been one less creature that Crazy Mage would have been able to play that was, you know, more powerful or more proactive.
How is he going to deal with this now? I think he's gonna tap here and see some options.
Yeah, he kind of has to tap. He can play Lotheb. The only reason he wouldn't tap is if he's afraid of combo like next turn. Because if he does tap and he doesn't find a way to deal with it, then he'd be tapping himself. Actually, he'd be in lethal range no matter what, because it'd be exactly 25 damage even if he doesn't tap. So yeah, tap is 100% the right play here. Oh,
that's a good. Implosion's nice. He doesn't have a swipe, so.
In the sea giant screen!
Oh, do it!
So, this is the exact type of play that I was talking about. If he trades in here, he takes off one creature, but he adds 2, so the net gain is the same. So, if he power overwhelmings here and kills off the Druid of the Claw, he can no longer play
the
sea giant.
Yeah. So, he has to make this choice right now.
Wait, no, he will be able to play the sea giant. Because he'll be taking off one.
Yep. It's just going to
be. But adding one. And it doesn't even add the 1 until the end of the turn, because the power of a woman trading in won't kill it. So there was absolutely no way that he could have been able to play the Sea Giant that turn and also play power of a warming. So he's already seen a swipe, so I do kind of agree with it. And
I agree with this play too. He can just drop the Sea Giant later next turn.
Yeah. There's that Big Game Hunter though. So we're making a big fuss about this. Pesky sea giant.
It's like we want to see it come down already.
Yeah.
But it won't stay long when it does come down.
Yeah, when in reality, another victim.
Oh, another one. This is good.
Okay. Yeah, and he can play both.
What?
That.
Oh. 2 sea giants.
I can hear the crowd cheering in the background just because he finally managed to get those sea giants down on the board.
Yeah, and when he did, he got 2 of them down.
Yeah. Well, you can deal with 1. But can you deal with 2? And the answer is no. So is this the start of a comeback for Next Gen? Because he's got such an intimidating board. And you have to sort of realize your win conditions here as Crazy Mage. Can you afford to, you know, start trading back onto the board? Or do you just have to, you know, start going face and hope that you draw into combo in time to kill your opponent? It's a tough decision.
I think he has to put down the Keeper, kill one of the 1/1s, and just hero power one of the other 1/1s.
Yeah. Is killing the 1/1s, Does that make a difference, though, or is the face damage more relevant? So if he attacks, the load that goes in the Sludge Belcher, and then two go in to the slime. Yeah, I think Keeper faces.
Oh.
Correct choice. He's got to set him up for lethal here.
Oh, I see. Yes, because he has the Savage Roar.
Yeah. So he's putting it on a play for where combo is going to win in the game. And now Next Gen has to think every turn, can I tap?
He must, and just hope for an Argus. Well, he does have a Voidwalker now.
Yeah, but that doesn't block too much.
Yeah.
One tree. Imp King boss is a reasonable minion, but it's not proactive. Doesn't do anything when it's placed on the board.
Man, all these matches are really close.
Yeah.
Just back and forth.
So he can take out the Belcher and the slime, but he has to leave two creatures on the board regardless.
He's going to have to trade into the Nax with his Sea Giant.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he can make the risky play and not trade in and hope that his Voidwalker holds up and that there's not a Force of Nature or a Savage Roar in the hand and set up a two-turn lethal. But I think he's going to have the two-turn lethal regardless, so... This saves more damage onto the Sea Giant, yeah. So it makes it harder to clear off. And this actually could be the difference because there's actually 13, 14, 15, 16 damage on board. Ooh. He would be able to Hero Power out of range of it. Yeah. So let me make sure that math's great. 13, 14, 15, 16.
It's 16. So he's going to get rid of the Void Walker. So he's going to have to hope he...
Oh, he can get rid of the Lothep too with the Living Roots. So that's actually a big deal. Yeah. It's... You can make the super, super risky play and play like the Shade so you have a guaranteed Savage Roar target on the board for next turn. And hold on to Living Roots for an extra 2 damage to the face. Mm-hmm. But then you'd be giving Next Gen so many outs. You know, Abusive Sergeant, Defender of Argus, you know, Power Overwhelming, because there's still one Power Overwhelming, a natural one, left in the deck since he got 2 earlier, but one was from a Dark Peddler.
Yeah, this is a tough turn for Crazy Mage.
Yeah, so.
There's like a couple of options. I'm going to take out the Lothab.
Yeah.
It's a good idea.
Yep. And making sure that he puts the maximum amount of... I doubt he'll trade. Yeah. Maximum amount of face damage in this turn. Owl doesn't help.
Ooh, he's going to have to tap.
If he taps... He knows that one of those cards is a combo piece, because Crazy Mage has been holding onto that for so long.
If he has a Leeroy and he taps into it, he can win.
Wow. That might be his out.
Yeah. If he has a Leeroy...
We've seen a couple players run Sea Giants and Doom Guards, which is an interesting choice, because a lot of times you run, if you run Sea Giants, you run Leeroy. Direwolf Alpha, not quite.
Is it enough to...
I think that's game regardless. No matter how he decides to trade here, even if he ticks off the Tides Power creatures, just Savage Roar will be enough to win the game. So.
Yeah. That is game for Crazy Mage is going to take it.
And if I were him, I wouldn't even play the Savage Roar.
Just I think to he's give, going to, yeah.
Okay, just to give my opponent the illusion that I top decked for the win.
So much damage.
Yeah, but that is going to be Crazy Mage taking a 2-0 lead in the series. And Next Gen did have some questionable lines, perhaps some mistakes, at least from his point of view. They didn't really end up mattering because actually holding on to the second Sea Giant made it so that he could do that turn where he played Lothep plus both Sea Giants at the same time, which wouldn't happen. Big Ape Hunter would have been a bigger swing in that case.
I think they both played that game really well.
Yeah.
It's just
except for the one turn.
Which turn was that again? The one you took.
She traded, yeah. I think he wanted to get the Sea Giant out that turn. But it was inconsequential from our point of view because we knew the Big Game Hunter was there. But from his point of view,
yeah,
it probably seemed
really
like
good,
a mistake.
Yeah.
So Paladin is the only deck left remaining for Crazy Mage. Is it Murloc Paladin?
So it's Zoo against... Is this Aggrodin?
No.
No, it's It's a secret pally with a Finley.
What?
Mm-hmm. I've seen that. Huh. It's rare, but there are some people who use it.
That seems weird. The deck is a lot about building up an insurmountable board. Oh, well, hello there.
Because if you get the steady shot,
The deck isn't about like bursting down your opponent. It's about, you know, building up a board and, you know, having that board that's almost impossible for your opponent to remove and having good board control. And the hero power helps you with that early on because, you know, you're creating a board from nothing. I guess Shapeshift is okay because it still is something that allows you to contest the board a little bit. Mm-hmm. But it just seems like a lot of times you don't need an extra one attack on your weapons.
Yeah.
Like on your Light's Justice for Muster for Battle, your Coghammer. It allows better trades, but I don't know. I'm not sure.
Yeah. I don't use a Sir Finley in mine. I just see it in aggro dens a lot.
Yeah. I don't even have a Secret Paladin deck. All my decks are control. I have 9 control warrior decks.
Really? When I faced you on the ladder, you were playing Zoo.
That wasn't me. That was a different Azumo cutie. I swear. Alright, well, this board is really annoying. Divine Shields galore. Can't even get past that Sir Finley to get to the Shield of Minibody. And there's a secret to deal with.
What's he gonna do here? Knife Juggler, Dire Wolf, trade with Imp Gang? Or is he gonna tap and Knife Juggler?
Knife Juggler and Dire Wolf. If the juggle hits the Sir Finley.
Yep.
And allows a really good trade. And also, the second juggle from the Imp Gang boss could land on the Shield of Minibot, which would get rid of the Divine Shield. So
yeah, the Divine Shields are annoying, and yeah, he needs to try and get rid of them.
Yeah. I think Knife Juggler Direwolf first. Oh, he's going to No, this is okay. He's going to Defender of Argus because he's going to make himself 2 targets.
Oh, okay. I see.
To Defender of Argus. So, in an environment where your opponent's playing a deck that's super board-centric, getting value out of Defender of Argus, full value out of Defender of Argus while you can, is actually really valuable. Just because you're never guaranteed a board. If he plays Knife Juggler, Direwolf Alpha, and all of a sudden Crazy Mage had a Consecration, he'd probably never be able to play that Defender of Argus again.
Yeah, I think next gen was just like, he didn't want to play the Juggler or the Wolf because of the Coghammer.
Yeah.
Also.
That's true. Very true. Good point. And if the juggles didn't hit the Shield of Minibot, that's a free trade. All right, well, double Knife Juggler is possible, but it seems like...
It's not that great with the Imp Gang.
Yeah.
He has to get rid of it first, and then maybe double juggle after hitting the Imp Gang.
Yeah. Oh, ho, ho. Let's move quickly. I don't think next gen is in a position here, down 2-0, to start making emotes like that.
That's true.
It's a bold call there, buddy. Yeah, I mean, this... The Keeper of Ultimate on the Sir Finley doesn't really accomplish too much. It just makes it so that it's harder. It's puts more damage onto whatever decides to trade in. And also a 3-4 body is just decent, so... even though he doesn't make immediate use out of the buff, the 3-3 buff, mm-hmm. that he puts onto the Sir Finley, it's still a very reasonable play.
Yeah, he's going to make next gen be the one to trade into his minions.
Yeah.
Ooh, but the Sea Giant is now ready to come down.
But you have to just play the Sea Giant.
Okay, he doesn't want to do it yet.
Oh no, the redemption. Since the redemption played, he can actually play the Sea Giant.
Oh my goodness.
There was no way he could have known that was redemption.
Yeah, that was crazy. That worked out really well for him.
That was a sick read. Or incredible luck.
Yeah.
One of the two. We'll go with sick read. We'll give him the benefit of the doubt. Because He hadn't killed a creature yet since that secret was played, so that could have been Avenge. He had ruled out Noble Sacrifice because he attacked in. He had ruled out Competitive Spirit because he had left creatures on the board. And he had ruled out Repentance because he played the Knife Juggler first. So the only two options that it could have been left were Redemption and Avenge.
Yeah.
And, you know, a bold call, but it definitely ends up being the correct one. So his risk pays off. And when you're down 2-0 in a series, sometimes you got to take those risky plays. Read them like a book.
Not going to get Gormok value here.
No, it's going to be very, very tough to get Gormok value with that type of hand.
Yeah, he's probably going to tap first.
He could just play the Gormok on the board and play the Direwolf Alpha, you know, just to try and contest as much as possible. If that's the case, you can, you know, just no. Throwing a Sea Giant into a Zombie Chow is probably one of the worst things you could possibly do.
You go face. Once you put down the Direwolf, you go face with the Sea Giant and you trade into the mini bot with your 1/1.
What's he thinking? He's thinking, wow, that last play was so
amazing.
Good. I'm a god. That's what he's saying in his head right now. All right. Yeah.
Okay, the Gormok on the left side.
That's what I'm talking about. All right, putting on the pressure. And the one thing about Secret Paladins is they don't have a way to deal with big stuff very well outside of Keeper of Alderman. And Next Gen has already seen a Keeper of Alderman, so that's another reason to add to the many lists of reasons why that Sea Giant is going face. And he can make some, you know, okay trades here. I think you want to kill the Direwolf Alpha first, so that way the Juggle has a better chance of going face. Very good.
Nice.
All right. Well.
Well, it's.
That's game.
Yeah, he's got two power overwhelmings.
You tried hard there, Crazy Mage.
And he's making the comeback.
Yeah. The first step is always the hardest.
Oh, a little bit.
The tap last for the Sergeant. Yeah, for the abusive Sergeant. And that's going to be Next Gen clawing his way back in the series, finally putting himself on the board. Taking one win. 2-1 now in the series. Crazy Mage doesn't look phased at all, though.
It's like, I got this. I got two wins.
Yeah. So he's still going to find a win with the that Paladin. Interesting Paladin deck. Sir Finley's, you know, it's a good card for decks where the hero power doesn't fit the identity of the deck. But I feel like for Secret Paladin...
Yeah, it's a bit strange.
The hero power does fit the identity of the deck. So, I mean, I guess it's a card that you can have just for the sometimes cases. Like, sometimes you do want a different hero power in some matchups. But most of the time you don't. And I guess you can just throw it away in opening hands where you don't want it. And then maybe just hold on to it until later when the hero power is less impactful.
It must be really helpful against like an aggro shaman and you pick heal.
Yeah, that's true. You can fight for the board more early on. Even ping in some matchups might be better. Because a 1-1 is sort of like a delayed ping that you can buff.
That's true.
That can't go through taunts. Yeah.
Also, this is the Next Gen's Secret Pally.
Yeah.
Secret Pally versus Secret Pally.
Yeah. And in Secret Paladin versus Secret Paladin, sometimes it's okay to keep Mysterious Challenger if you have a good curve. And Crazy Mage definitely didn't have a good curve. You can also keep Mysterious Challenger sometimes when you're on the coin. If you see your opponent throw away most of their cards in the mulligan, if you know it's a Secret Paladin mirror, because your opponent's less likely to have a good curve, your Mysterious Challenger is going to come down first because you have the coin. So there's some cases in which you do keep Mysterious Challenger if you have the coin as well. So
yeah, it's always nice to be the first person that puts out the Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah. Especially if you're running Repentance. Because if you put down your Mysterious Challenger first and you're running Repentance, if your opponent puts down theirs, then it's at one health all of a sudden.
That's true. I don't see a lot of Repentance, though.
Yeah. It's getting rarer.
People are mixing up the secrets, though.
I am sorry. I wonder how long it'll be before we see Eye for an Eye. Sorry. and Secret Paladin.
Oh, actually, no. That's the worst one. I've never seen that.
That's the worst one.
I've seen the.
Those are big words. You're saying Sacred Trial is better than Eye for an Eye.
I've actually seen Sacred Trial being used quite a few times.
I wholeheartedly disagree. Eye for an Eye is the best secret in the entire game.
Yeah, that seems...
So you know how the player Tars, he played Curse of Rafam in his Zoo Warlock deck to counter Freeze Mage? Because the Curse of Rafam damage, when the curse is in your hand, procs on your opponent's turn. So it goes through Ice Block. Eye for an Eye, in a meta where there's a lot of Freeze Mages, could be a tech to beat it. Because you play it right before they're about to do the killing blow, and then they just power blast their own face. And it goes through Ice Block.
That's
and at the very least, you force a draw. It's an interesting concept. I've yet to play around with it.
Wait, he has a
He has a two? Oh, my goodness gracious.
Maybe they're practice buddies.
That's possible. You know, maybe I'm just hating on this card a little too much. Maybe it's actually really good in Secret Paladin. Chalk does not think so. Chalk disapproves.
And we're going to see the Druid hero power once again.
Yeah. Yeah, he's got a board lead, so he might as well trade in there to make sure that he protects his board as much as possible. Also, he doesn't want to get punished by Blessing of Kings, which is just picked up in the hand of Crazy Mage, because that Divine Shield ends up making Blessing of Kings super high value. And I don't know if Divine Favor is going to get
What's
much value
holding?
In this matchup. You know, another thing is Crazy Mage actually runs a quality also.
Yeah, that's very different.
Yeah. It's very weird. Oh.
Okay. Are you gonna play Repentance here?
It's going into turn 5.
Yeah.
It could hit a Lotheb, it could hit a Belcher, which are pretty big targets. So Consecration into a Mysterious Challenger the next turn, but he's gonna play his Mysterious Challenger second. Maybe you just Lotheb. You know, take the Repentance. Well, you don't know it's Repentance, so take that back. Options.
The Lotheb looks better here for next gen, but he doesn't know it's Repentance.
Yeah, he could also attack face with the Sir Finley first, just to check to see if it's a Noble Sacrifice, which could eliminate some of the thoughts that are going on in his head. Because since there's one secret up, with that being the play, he doesn't risk giving over an Avenge.
I would definitely check it first. And you should check it with the Sir Finley first.
All right. Because if he hits a Shield of Minibot, Avenge and Redemption punish him very heavily. And now he sees that it's not Avenge either, so he's like, okay, it's either Competitive Spirit or Repentance. Mm-hmm. He's going to hope for another sick read, but he's not going to get it.
He's nodding his head over there.
Yeah.
So.
Hello, challenger. None of your business. We can see that next gen leveled up to level 20 in World of Warcraft. Thanks for showing that off, buddy.
Have you done that?
I have not. No.
I haven't done it. I'm level 7.
I don't play Paladin enough to warrant it, but I'll probably do it eventually. It is a pretty cool hero skin.
I wonder when the next ones are coming out. The
Who
next
knows?
Hero ones.
Who knows? Blizzard knows. Alright, well, now this is a...
Does he want to pop the secrets, or does he want to just pass?
I think he just wants to pass. Because if your opponent has Competitive Spirit, you're giving... Well, I guess there's only 3 secrets, so you can sort of rule out the possibility Competitive Spirit and Redemption. Because Redemption plus Competitive Spirit plus like Noble Sacrifice and Avenge would put so much more power into the board. And so this way he checks for Competitive Spirit. So now he can narrow down to exactly what those 3 secrets are, which is Noble Sac, Avenge, and Redemption. I think these decks are...
Probably the same.
Yeah, identical, if not very similar.
They both have Repentance. They both have Sir Finley. We just have to see if next gen runs a equality also. Mm-hmm.
All right. If he can get... Oh, this is actually a really good play. Because he'll guarantee that the event goes on the...
On a 1-1.
Ooh, no.
Oh.
Not true. Well met. I don't think he... He might not have thought that play through. Because I think he was thinking he was going to be able to clear it off. And then consecrate, clear the board, and event would pop on the... Mysterious Challenger, allowing him to play the Eldar Peacekeeper on the Mysterious Challenger and have a really clean board. But this way, now he has to sort of take a lot of damage onto this Mysterious Challenger to, you know, come up with the same effect. And even just the one attack from Mysterious Challenger. Oh, okay.
Oh, he doesn't want to trade into anything.
Headed upstairs. Equality in Seeker Paladin.
I think it's because he's just waiting for his consecration.
Yeah, but even consecration has been frequently a one of in most Secret Paladin decks. I mean, I guess they do, especially with Sir Finley, have multiple ways to deal one damage to a quality minions.
I know that Reyna doesn't like consecration in Secret Paladin.
Yeah, it sort of works against what you're trying to do. If you're using consecration on turn 4, it means you're not building a board.
Yeah.
So.
I understand that.
Yeah, a lot of times the one of is for the matchups where you fall behind a board early anyway, like Zoo and occasionally Aggro Shaman and other Secret Paladins. But in every other matchup, the consecration becomes a liability, and you'd much rather have consistency of draw in the 4 slot instead. Like maybe a True Server Champion if you didn't run one already, or double Paladin Shredder plus double Keeper of Oldemon, which a lot of times you have to make a cut for the consecration. So
the Druid Hero Power is going to do some work here.
Yeah?
He wouldn't have been able to go through that otherwise.
They're proving. It's terrible. It's got to be terrible. Ah. I'm going to have to go home later and just spam games with Sir Finley Murgleton Secret Paladin. I'm going to do extensive testing. I'll come back tomorrow and tell everybody, tell the world my findings. That Divine Favor is not doing next gen any favors.
Yeah. I think he doesn't want to use his True Silver.
Well, he if he uses the Owl here, he can get one card from the Divine Favor. But if a Tyrion comes out and he doesn't have an Owl...
It's worth it, Divine Favor.
Yeah.
At this point, you need to, you know, make a bigger board than your enemy.
Yeah. Oh, one man off from being able to play the Belcher, but this is a full board clear. With the Druid Hero Power. But he leaves...
It's putting work.
Sure. Yeah.
I like your reaction.
Putting in a lot of work.
That heal is nice.
Yeah. Well, this is going to be sort of a top deck war here. A draw war. And we'll see who can get the big buff first in the Tyrion.
Oh, he got it.
Right after the Owl was played, the ultimate punish in next
gen.
Oh,
no. Look at next gen is so disappointed.
That Ming Li should be a not like this face.
He could blessings his Belcher.
He's going to have to attack into the Tyrion here.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good response, but he's out of cards. And there's going to be an Ashbringer once this Tyrion inevitably... Oh! No way!
No!
And next gen is... this is... Keep in mind, this is an elimination match. This is the lower bracket. So the loser of this match will be eliminated.
Top deck after top deck.
Yeah. That's a clutch set of draws in a row for Crazy Mage. And next gen... is sort of just dealing with the fact that he's got to accept.
Unless a Tyrion comes out.
Even a Tyrion, I don't think, would save
yeah,
him.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. It would stall it. No, actually, it wouldn't.
All right. Well, that is Crazy Mage taking the series 3-1. moving on further into the lower bracket, and unfortunately, that means his countryman, Next Gen, has been eliminated from the Singapore Major. Exchanging some words.
And, that was a crazy match.
Goodness, crazy match looks so happy. Oh, wow. Yeah. A little bit of a friendly competition there. Always good to see. Yeah, we talked about it earlier. The Southeast Asian community and the Asia-Pacific community in general seems to be more about camaraderie than a lot of the other regions.
It's really cool because a lot of them are actually meeting each other face-to-face for the first time.
Yeah, that's true.
They've just seen each other a lot online. And this event got them all together.
Yeah. And, they probably played online with each other for potentially years.
Mm-hmm.
And they can see the updated winner's bracket. So some notables moving on to the winner's bracket round that were played off stream. Waning Moon, popular player from the Philippines. Pew Pew Your Face, he played in the 2015 Southeast Asia Finals. Fitzdarth, who I believe is one of the Malaysian players. Very, very popular guy over there. And Infernity, who took second place at the Southeast Asia qualifier, the Southeast Asia preliminary. And then there's, of course, we saw Handsome Guy earlier. Silent Stormy making it through as well. And Tom, the Taiwanese player. And Kranich also moving on in the winner's bracket. So a lot of known names. And you practice with Waning Moon.
Yes, I do. He's like my mentor.
Your mentor. Okay, well, those are some strong words. What do you think his chances are of making it all the way? I know he's listening
right
now.
He's a really strong player.
Mm.
He analyzes everything.
Yeah, well, he's made it to the winner's match, or the winner's round of 16.
He actually won the Gosu Cup, not the last one, but the one before that, recently, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, there's also a lot of players here who participate in the Gosu Cup for Southeast Asia. But that's going to do it for that match. We are going to head into more lower bracket matchups in a bit, but we are going to have to take a quick commercial break before we jump into that. But don't go anywhere, guys, because more Hearthstone Singapore Major action will continue right after this.